Welcome to the Mixology Talk Podcast.
I'm Chris.
And I'm Julia, and we're the folks behind abarabove.com, the ultimate resource for craft bartenders, bar operators, and just about anybody else looking to make great craft drinks.
I'm a bar consultant with more than 10 years of industry experience.
And I run abarabove.com, bringing weekly articles and cocktail recipes to help you make great drinks and grow your career behind the bar. This is episode 92, and today we were lucky enough to catch an interview with Jordan Silbert, the CEO and founder of Q Drinks. He's a bit of a perfectionist, like a lot of us cocktail nerds, but in this case, it really paid off. Listen in to hear his story of why he decided to set about making a better tonic, how he did it, and how his company grew from there. As always, you can find the show notes for this episode at mixologytalk.com/92. By the way, not only is this episode about Q Drinks, it's also sponsored by Q Drinks. You'll learn a lot more about them in the interview to follow, but I have to say, I've been really impressed with the quality, carbonation level, and flavor profile of their tonic, grapefruit, and ginger beer mixers, along with the rest of their portfolio. They're made with real, carefully chosen ingredients and designed to let you create a complete balanced cocktail with just their mixers and your spirit of choice. Thanks again to Q Drinks for sponsoring this podcast. Jordan, thanks so much for joining us.
Hello.
So before we get too far into this podcast, I thought I would just start with a really boring question, which is, can you just tell us a bit about yourself and your role at Q Drinks?
So my name is Jordan, and I am the founder and CEO of Q Drinks. I started the thing in my kitchen, 10 years ago, and now I'm running the company.
Wow. So you were doing craft mixers before it was cool.
Yeah, I was doing it just to drink is the real answer.
Really? So is that why you started it?
Yeah, totally. Like, I'll give you the full story. Yeah. One night I had a bunch of pals over my backyard and we were drinking gin and tonics, and a couple of drinks in, my teeth started getting sticky and I was like, that's kind of weird. And I picked up the bottle of Schweppes and looked at it and saw the ingredients. It was, 32 grams of high fructose corn syrup, natural and artificial flavors, sodium benzoate. I was like, that's kind of weird. I thought like tonic water was like some bitter water, but I hadn't really ever thought about it. And one of my good friends, I guess then girlfriend and now wife and mother of his two kids, she was drinking a Sprite. She had like a tummy ache that night. So I was like, hey, Sarah, can I look at your Sprite? And she said, sure. And I looked at the ingredients and I was like, 32 grams of high fructose corn syrup, natural and artificial flavors, sodium benzoate. And one of my good friends was like telling the same stupid story he always tells. So I was like, guys, these are like the same thing. The Schweppes and 7-Up or Sprite, they're just yellow and green, but they're like the same ingredients.
That is crazy. I have never made that comparison myself.
Yeah, so 3 or 4 gin and tonics helps clarify your thinking. And
always.
Yeah, either that or have boring enough friends that you think about other things while they're telling stories. But yeah, so I realized that, and we started talking about a bunch of other things, but the idea just stuck in my head. And a couple more drinks in, and this is back in my youth when I used to be able to have 6 gin and tonics on a Tuesday night and be okay on Wednesday morning. The Tanqueray bottle was there, like glowing in the moonlight, this orb of a green gin goodness there floating above the table. And it was like a perfect summer night in Brooklyn, and my best friends in the world were there, and it's a gorgeous night, and the gin was obviously terrific. And I looked at the bottle of tonic water and I was like, what a piece of crap. The thing was,
yeah, this doesn't belong here.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it was crusty on top. The thing was dented. The label was peeling off. And I was like, why is there not a better tonic water? And I was like, I'm going to make a better tonic water. And long story short, I did. Long story a little longer, next morning, kind of figured out what tonic water was or was supposed to be, this like thing called quinine, which initially came, it's like an alkaloid that initially came from a tree bark, a little sugar and some carbonated water. But the big soda guys had treated it as something like a soda for the last 50 or 60 years. So I ordered a bag of bark on the internet and started mixing stuff up in my kitchen. Eventually, I came up with something I loved or I liked. My roommate would complain that we were going to, first of all, that was making a big mess, but he joked that we're going to get busted for running a meth lab because I had pots and pans, everything boiling. But I came up with like quinine like kind of tincture. And I'd get invited over to someone's house for drinks and I'd bring that and make homemade gin and tonics. But it was put the gin in, put some ice, put that the quinine syrup on top and then some carbonate water on top of that. It was like, if you've seen any of these craft quinine syrups now, like Tomer's or Jack Rudy's or one of those. So it was basically that. And people loved it, but the bubble, I was like totally down this rabbit hole by this time. And the bubbles would drive me nuts because I was, you know, just topping it with club soda and stirring it real fast. And
right.
It would go flat. And I was just, yeah, I was just down this rabbit hole. So I was like, I'm going to find a soda plant to make me a couple hundred cases. So I did. One guy made the mistake. I called around a bunch. One guy made the mistake of picking up the phone once. And so I made it. And I thought I'd just kind of give it away. First of all, drink myself, but also just give it away to my friends for their birthdays or whatever. But I posted on some like foodie internet site, eGullet. And I said, you know, I'm Jordan. I'm from Brooklyn. I made this tonic water. Does anyone want to try it? And it was kind of the rise. It was right then. This was like 2007, I guess.
Yeah, I think eGullet was big back then.
Yeah. And it was like the rise of the mixology movement, like the very beginning of it. And like in retrospect, it all makes sense. You know, it's pretty easy for a good bar owner to put rosemary in his vodka and infuse the rosemary or squeeze fresh grapefruit juice or muddle real basil leaves. But to make carbonated tonic water, you had to be an idiot to go so far down the rabbit hole that you found a soda plant to make it. And just people hadn't gotten it that far.
Well, not only that, but there's a safety element to it too, right?
The quinine or the carbonation?
Or the quinine, unless there's something about the carbonation too.
Yeah, quinine, that's easily solvable. That's just how much you put in. Like you just do the math and put in the right amount, assuming you're extracting it in the right way. But you should be able to do the math and not kill yourself. It's the carbonation that you just like need a big carbo cooler that if it like blows up, the whole block blows up. Like, but that you just need a commercial factory to really have enough power to get the carbonation that I wanted into the bottle.
I definitely did not know that. I knew about the sort of safety risks of quinine, but to your point, it's just a matter of doing your homework, which it doesn't sound like you have any trouble with doing your homework.
No, also, if you do your homework, you also just do a lot of it. Like, I was down a rabbit hole. I was just consumed with it. And I spent a ton of time figuring it all out. And I asked 1,000 people and, you know, I figured it out. But yeah, once I did my homework, I just did the math. So anyway, yeah, I posted on this website and then like, almost immediately, Jim Meehan, who went on to start PDT, at that point was the head bartender at Gramercy Tavern. And he reached out and said, hey, Jordan, I'd love to try it. Can you bring it by the tavern? I was like, what tavern? He said, Gramercy Tavern. I was like, whoa, heard of that place.
Wait a minute.
So I went down. He loved it, wanted to buy it. I said, that's great. He said, who's your distributor? I was like, distributor? I've never even heard of a distributor. What do you mean? And he said, okay, well, I'll go get you set up with finance. And I did a bunch of paperwork. And by the time I got back to my house, I'd gotten an email from Sasha from Milk and Honey. And he, you know, had a ridiculous email address, like, you know, Death Star, whatever. He said, you know, can you bring it by the bar? And I said, you know, what bar? And he said, Milk and Honey. And I said, I'd love to. And so I went down there. He loved it. And he knew from whence I came that I did not know anything about anything. He said, you know, can you deliver it tonight after close? So I said, sure. What time's close? He said, 2:30 in the morning. So I delivered it. I borrowed a car and delivered the first cases 2:30 in the morning. And he paid me cash out of the register.
That's shady, man.
I got to say, that's a pretty incredible way to start.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Yeah, what a hit list too, man.
Yeah, a couple of weeks later, Simon Ford, another of the big wigs, reached out to me. He at that point was at Plymouth Gin, and they were sponsoring a big event at Rockefeller Center where people, you know, paid $1,000 or whatever for a tasting plate where you can get like pig butt from Tom Colicchio or salad from Alice Waters. And they were going to do some wacky cocktail, but he had our tonic water, my tonic water at Milk and Honey, and he wanted to do Ultimate Gin Tonics. So he called me up and said, you know, can I talk to someone in the marketing department? And I was like, you know, first of all, how the hell did you get my number? Second of all, we don't have a marketing department. Third, that's me.
I'm the CEO and I'm the janitor, right?
Exactly. And I said, sure, I'd love to do it. So I showed up with 10 cases and we had a grand old time, drank way too many gin tonics. But the New York Times was there. Florence Fabricant from New York Times was at the event and she tried the gin tonic and then the tonic and absolutely loved it. And the next morning, I got a call from the fact-checking department of the New York Times that we were going to be on the front page of the Dining In section, you know, 4 days later. And I was like, oh my God, that's awesome. And oh my God, what do I do? Like, I don't have a website. I don't have anything. So I got a website up in 3 days. And then the article hit and I got calls from, you know, bars and restaurants, awesome ones in New York City, around the country. Bars in Japan were calling me on my cell phone. I said no to just about everyone except for a couple in New York City that I could deliver to.
Yeah. I mean, you've got a serious supply problem all of a sudden, right?
I just had, you know, whatever, it's 150, 200 cases in my basement in Brooklyn. But the Whole Foods flagship store in Austin, Texas asked to buy a pallet. And it's my hot tip to young entrepreneurs. When you're starting a company and somebody wants to buy something and you don't quite know what it is, say yes. So I said yes. And while I was Googling, you know, what a pallet was, I was like, oh, that's what those wooden things are. I was like, huh, how do you get one of those? And then how do you get your boxes of soda on your out of the basement onto one of those? And how do you get one of those down to Texas? But anyway, I figured that out. Exactly. And then my sent it down to Texas. And then my then girlfriend, now wife and mother of my two children, and I went down to Austin, Texas, and by day did demos and sold through the pallet. And when I, by night, you know, drank margaritas and ate Tex-Mex food, but had a grand old time. And by the time I came back to New York, I was like, wow, I think I have something here. And that was, I guess, just over 9 years ago. And I want to say it's been candy canes and roses since, but it's been a long, exciting, hard, but also incredibly fun 9 years now.
That is an amazing story. I had no idea that you had started in such, frankly, famous bars from the mixology movement. That's the way to start with Jim Meehan.
It is, but it's not like I was a gifted salesperson at all. It was kind of the right thing at the right time with an awesome product. Like, it's not like I knew anything about how to do it. Like, I made something that was better. And then he tried it. He said, I want to get it. And the same thing with Sasha. And it was just at the right time when everybody was starting to think about how do you make bars like as terrific or even more terrific than the food that you get at a great restaurant.
Well, I think that's just such a great point though. And that is that you didn't need the marketing department because it just tasted good.
Right. Exactly. And then so from day one, like Jim was asking me, hey, can you make a ginger ale? Because I'm embarrassed to have, you know, the Schweppes ginger ale next to your tonic water. And while you're at it, club soda should be pretty easy. And what about a ginger beer and a cola? And I just like didn't have my act together.
Well, that's a pretty tall order for, you know, one messy kitchen to put together a whole product line.
Yeah. I think in retrospect, when we're really successful, everybody's going to say I was a genius to wait to get the tonic water. You know, the tonic water were nationwide at Whole Foods. It was at, you know, fancy bars and restaurants or across the country. And then, you know, it took me 4 years to do the second flavor, the ginger ale. Everybody's going to say I was a genius for waiting so long. And it was more, I just didn't have my act together. I literally would spend a week at the bottling plant filling the stuff, then drive down to the city, spend a week, you know, delivering the stuff, then spend the next week trying to sell to more people. And then the fourth week, I don't even know what I did, but it was not, didn't have time to figure out another, how to make ginger ale. And I just did that. I was like on this carousel or merry-go-round or whatever it was for a while. But I think when we succeed or when it works, everybody's like, oh, you took so long in the ginger ale. And I think what we did was right. Like, I could have just gone with my first recipe on the ginger ale, or even worse, I could have bought some off-the-shelf flavor. By that point, we had people calling to offer us off-the-shelf flavors, but I just knew the ginger ale had to be awesome, and that would give us kind of permission to make other flavors. But each and every one, what's the Jay-Z line that I treat my first like my last and my last like my first? That it's just like in each one, the product needs to be there, the quality that Jim Meehan and Sasha want to buy it. And if that happens, if you can make that awesome product, then the rest of the stuff will take care of itself. And I just knew that because of how I started. I knew how little I knew and how many things I screwed up, and I still had all these fancy places buy it. Therefore, I knew that the quality of the product had to be the first and foremost thing I thought about.
Yeah. I think that's something that our industry really appreciates. There's a lot of sort of 80-20 industries out there, but I think for a lot of folks in the bar world, especially the craft bar side of things, there's a respect for perfectionism, for really waiting to get it right. And that doesn't, of course, mean that every single thing you make takes half an hour to make it, you know, but I think there's respect for getting the recipe right and taking the time that's required to get there.
Yeah. Yeah. Like customers deserve that. Like, if I have a drink, I want it to be terrific. You know, I work pretty hard and I want that drink at 8, not at 5 o'clock, but it's 8, 9 or 10 o'clock to be awesome. And the way to make awesome drinks is to have awesome things go into the drinks and then, you know, mix them together in the right way.
Well, I mean, the thing that I have noticed is, for example, the master distiller of Tanqueray, like you mentioned, is somebody with decades of experience, an incredibly skilled, talented person, and then you pour Schweppes into it. I mean, just like you mentioned earlier, it's such a shame, really. So I'm so excited to see that we're starting to see, at least on our side of the country, we're starting to see brands like yours that put the attention into the mixer as well.
Yeah, so I guess there's two things I want to add. One, that it's not just Tanqueray. Tanqueray makes an awesome gin, but it is a phenomenal time to be a drinker right now. There are so many, like the big guys generally do a really good job on their spirits, whether it be a white spirit or brown spirit, they do a really good job more often than not. But there's also all these craft spirits out there, and each and every distiller is agonized over, you know, what botanicals to put in, what the shape of the still is, how many times to run it through the still. And yeah, it just doesn't make sense to put, you know, what they come up with, mix it with something that's just basically crap. So that's the first point. The second point I didn't mention about is, so not only our stuff, I think, is really, really good for a couple reasons. One, you know, we use real quinine from real trees, real ginger from real ginger root, real grapefruit from real grapefruits. But then one of our other big things, and then a lot more carbonation, we use custom thick bottles that allow us to put a lot of carbonation in, and then we treating carbonation like an ingredient, so each flavor has a different carbonation level. But setting aside those two points, I think the real secret of why our stuff tastes so good is because it has a lot less sugar than Schweppes or Canada Dry or other factory mixers. First of all, I guess we use organic agave instead of regular high fructose corn syrup. But even more important is we use a lot less of it. Sugar is bad for you for a lot of reasons. It makes you tired, it makes you fat, it makes you lazy. But if you're a drinker, it's bad for a really important reason. It masks the subtlety of whatever you're mixing it with. So, you know, think about Prohibition era cocktails. They're really, really sweet. You know why that is?
I don't.
Because they're making the gin in the bathtub, and you wanted to cover up all those impurities. Or think about when you're, you know, starting to drink, whether it be at, you know, 13, 16, 18, whenever it is, you drink it Everclear with Tang or Kool-Aid or wine coolers, but you're generally very sweet drinks. And that's because when you're young, you don't like the taste of booze. So you're putting a lot of sugar on it to hide the taste of booze. That's fine. However, if you really like a great gin, a great whiskey, a great vodka, and you like it for all the subtleties that this master distiller has agonized over, you want to be able to taste those subtleties. And if your mixer has too much sugar, it just covers all of those up. So that's one of the special things about ours compared to even other craft mixers. It's a lot less sweet. And that, again, lets the subtleties of a great spirit shine.
Well, I think that's definitely something that is especially challenging to find with your ginger ales. I am guilty of dismissing ginger ale as a mixer category completely, just because it's always so darn sweet. I'll just skip to the ginger beer instead. But to your point, I think there is a certain degree of finesse there, and it's dangerous to just pour a bunch of sugar into things. It kills the balance, and it just completely overwhelms any subtlety in the spirit itself.
And the ginger beers are, you say ginger ale sweet. Some of these ginger beers are like obnoxiously sweet.
That's true.
Well, one that I probably shouldn't name, but comes in a 12-ounce can, I think has 30% more sugar than Coke. That these are really, really sweet beverages.
Wow, I'm going to have to take a look at that the next time I'm drinking it. I should say a non-Q drinks one. So tell me a little bit about the development process. You mentioned your messy kitchen and your sort of not quite meth lab that you were running in Brooklyn. But I mean, how did you go about that with, especially with your later products, which did require some botanicals, like, for example, I don't know, your grapefruit or the ginger products. How did you go and make those? Were you still in your own kitchen at that time?
No. Now I've got a guy who has a bigger, fancier kitchen that helps measure everything, and it works out a lot better because I did my homework, but I didn't always execute my homework very well. But now I got a guy who helps me do that.
That makes a lot of sense.
But I'm still the one, and, you know, we just came out with, or I guess I'll, for example, on our ginger beer, I think we went through 26 different variations before we settled on one. The grapefruit was something like, I think it was 29 variations. So I got a guy who actually does the mixing for me and, you know, make sure it's exactly the way I want it, but it's still me tasting all these variations like, oh, this is perfect, except can we do this? Can we do that? And then I agonize over it. I have a couple friends who I share, I respect their palates and I share the prototypes with them. And then I come back and we make another round. And finally I get something that I like and it comes, obviously comes out the way I think is fantastic.
Yeah. It's, that's something that we see even in our own bar, when we're trying to create an infusion, it's so hard to create something that's repeatable. And it's so important that you are super, super perfectionist with your measurements, with every little thing you do, documenting the time, the temperature, you know, all of this sort of stuff, because otherwise you're never going to replicate it. And that is really frustrating when you made something really great the first time.
100%. And I realize there's some things I'm better at and other things I'm not as good at. And I'm pretty good at knowing what I want and then making sure what is in the bottle is what I want. I was less good at writing all that stuff down in a really meticulous way and making sure that what I am trying to do, I do.
So you mentioned that you had sort of your brain trust of friends who would help you decide. I mean, that's going to be another really challenging sort of decision, right? If you come down to your three best recipes, I mean, do you just vote at the end or how do you make that call?
No, it's a, what's the George Bush? I'm the decider. Like ultimately
you get the veto.
I do what I think is spectacular. Like I certainly ask people, hey, what do you think about this? Would this be too spicy for you? Is that punchy enough? Is it too sweet? Is it too dry? So I ask people about it, but ultimately I decide what I think is terrific.
Oh, that's great. And I think that's something that we run into as well is everybody's tastes are different. And so there's no such thing as the best ginger ale or the best ginger beer. Because what I like versus what you like or what Chris likes might be completely different.
Totally. And you can't like put it into an algorithm, or maybe that's what the big companies do, but like you can't put it into like a computer and out pops whatever of the right answer. Like you got to taste it. You got to talk to people. I highly advise mixing the drinks, a bunch of them. You usually have some additional clarity after a couple of drinks. And I've now done it. You know, we've got 6 flavors. So I've now done it a bunch and I now am much better at getting to where I want to get. And when I ask people's feedback, people use different words to mean different things. And that took me a while to figure out just like maybe the way I talk about taste is a different way that somebody else does. So when they say something to me, I almost have to translate it in my head to get what they're saying in the language that I might use. So I've just gotten better at it is the answer.
Yeah, that's a skill in and of itself. We were speaking with somebody in the wine field, and she was talking about the wine classes she taught and how one of the first things she has to teach is sort of the language that you speak. Because we don't often talk about flavor sort of as people. You know, I don't eat rice and say, you know, this tastes like X. No, I say it tastes like rice, which is not very useful if you're trying to make a better rice recipe, for example. So it's its own challenge to kind of learn that recipe.
Yeah, totally.
So I did want to ask you one more thing, because I know that with Q Drinks, I mean, I like ginger ale and ginger beer on its own. I'm the first to say that. And the same, actually, I like quite like tonic as well. But I know that the way that you really want these products to be enjoyed is mixed with spirits. Is that correct?
Yeah.
So, I mean, when you look at the craft cocktail movement, I mean, you see a lot of these, you know, 7-part cocktails, the super fancy, complicated drinks. Do you think that simplifying the quote unquote craft down to a mixer and a spirit, does it kind of take away the theatrical hospitality experience?
No.
So, I mean, tell me a little bit more about that. How do you solve that problem of a customer going into a bar and they say, I want a fantastic gin and tonic, or I want something delicious, surprise me. And the bartender pours a 2-part cocktail and it's kind of done very quickly. You know, how do we as a industry keep that special?
So I think there's a couple of ways to look at that. But I think first and foremost, I think it's important to put as someone in the industry to put yourself in the customer's shoes, and that I, as a customer, would much rather a fantastic drink than a complicated drink. And some 7-part cocktails are fantastic, but a lot of them are only okay. Whereas a gin and tonic with our gin and with a great gin in our tonic, each and every time is going to be fantastic and spectacular. And someone's going to be really, really happy with it. And there's ways to make it a little more special, put a different type of garnish in it, put, some sort of infusion into the spirit or a simple syrup on top of it. But ultimately, you can make a fantastic two-ingredient cocktail and the customer is going to be delighted. A. B, there's a way in which you can serve it. So the drink is not just, again, going back to theatrics, it's not just literally the liquid, in the person's mouth. It's more than that. It's the entire experience. And what we talk about is a thing called a spectacular serve. If you go to Western Europe and you get a gin and tonic, they always give you the glass bottle of tonic or of ginger beer or of ginger ale, the mixer, alongside your glass, which is usually filled with ice and some booze and a garnish. And that the server starts by pouring off, maybe halfway full through the glass of the mixer, and then lets the customer decide how much of the how strong or how weak they want the drink to be. And so there's a way to delight the customer with that type of experience. So someone orders a gin and tonic. Instead of plopping, waiting a couple minutes and plopping down a big glass of clear liquid in front of their table, you show up with a tray with a glass filled with ice, 2 ounces of booze in, or a couple ounces of booze in, and a garnish on top. And then you put that down in front of them. Then you open up the bottle. And when you open our bottle up, it goes pop really loud because tonic water has, 4.3 gas volumes in it. So it pops really loud. Then you pour it in front of them, pour it about halfway, and then you put the bottle down next to it. That is special. That makes you feel as a customer like you got treated with tremendous hospitality. Think about why people go out to dinner or go out to drinks. They're going to spend more money than they would at their own house. And, most people have food and have drinks at their own house. But the reason they're going out is for an experience they couldn't or wouldn't have at their own house. So to be treated like that with your gin and tonic feels really, really special, that someone thought about what would make me the happiest, that this gin and tonic was presented to me in this really, really special way. And then when I taste it, it's like, whoa, that's the best tasting gin and tonic, or the best tasting Moscow Mule, or the best tasting sparkling Paloma I've ever had. And so you as a guest are really happy. And again, the bar, they didn't do 7 ingredients in their cocktail, but they delighted their guest anyway. And that seems to be something that more and more bars are offering their guests and seem to be happy to do so.
Yeah, I think it's to your point, it's all about the guest experience and how you get there. Well, there's a lot of ways to get there. And I think one of the things that we saw a few years ago in the craft bar scene is a lot of folks were making complicated drinks for complicated drinks' sake. And I have had some fantastic complicated drinks, but that doesn't necessarily, it isn't what brings me to the bar necessarily. And so I think that's a great punchline, is just to remember it's about the guest experience. And there's lots of different ways to create an amazing guest and memorable guest experience.
And frankly, you should do both, probably is the answer. You should have a couple complicated cocktails or a couple more intricate cocktails on the menu. You should also have wonderful gin and tonics and wonderful Moscow Mules. And me, as someone who spends a lot of time at bars, sometimes I want really elegantly prepared specialty cocktail. And other times I want a really spectacular gin and tonic. And I think that's the other answer, is they're not mutually exclusive and it's not one or the other. But everybody should have awesome gin and tonics. There's no reason to go to a bar, especially one that has great other drinks, or a restaurant that has great other foods, and to get a soda gun gin and tonic, just the same thing that you could get at a corner bar down the street.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And I did have one sort of question for you that's actually specific to your ginger products, because we were tasting these earlier, and I do not have the best palate. I'll be the first to admit that. Chris is the one with the expert palate, but I seem to notice they both actually have like a pepper heat to them. Tell me a little bit about that, because that's not something that I would expect to taste in a ginger ale, for example. Like, what inspired you to go in that direction?
So there's two types of heats. There's probably 2.5 types of heats. There's ginger heat and there's cayenne heat. And we put them both in because we wanted, the ginger heat tends to be at the back of the mouth and it tends to be at the end of the drink. Also builds. So on the first drink, it's a little spicy. On the second drink, it's more spicy. On the third drink, it gets even more spicier. Cayenne tends to be at the front of the palate, at the beginning of the tongue, and on the first beat. And we wanted I've now gotten pretty good at figuring out what I want. And so we wanted that spice to be both at the beginning and the end is what we were looking for. And so cayenne, it's also a different, it's a different type of heat. It's how you describe it. It's drier, it's redder. I don't, there's different ways that I would describe it, but that's just what I was looking for in the, particularly in the ginger beer. There's a lot more of it in the ginger beer than the ginger ale. The ginger beer, we really wanted somebody to get a blast of spice in their ginger with some fullness with the agave. And then we also put some rose oil and coriander and cardamom in there to give it a little more depth and complexity. But yeah, it was something that we were looking for.
That's really creative though, to think about the sort of the place on the palate. Cause I definitely assumed there would be the ginger heat, but I was surprised when I first tasted it to get that sort of more rounder, different kind of heat as well.
Yeah. We're treating our mixers like the best distillers treat their spirits. And these guys agonize about what botanicals to use. And again, how many times to run it through the still, what still to use. And we have the same care and quality and agony that we put into our recipes. And it's just something that I was excited about when I was making that ginger beer.
I definitely appreciate that. So I definitely want to wrap this up to respect your time, but I did have one more question for you. And that is, a lot of folks who listen to this podcast make their own stuff. They make infusions. They work with botanicals. They are making huge messes in their own kitchens, respectively. Do you have any advice for folks when it comes to flavor extraction? Any either techniques for making it work really well? Or I mean, what I'd love to hear is, you've mentioned several times today that you know what you want by now, and now you know how to get it. That's actually a pretty tough skill to come by. You know, how do you have any advice for folks who are working on making their own ingredients at home and helping them do that better?
I think the whole answer is just like get consumed by it, or at least that's what I did, and just like go down that rabbit hole. And I just was so, I did it so many times when I was at the beginning. I just like knew every single thing and knew, and I got to a point where if I, you know, I pulled this lever, then this box would open. Kind of, I just was so consumed by it that I knew so much about it, and I'd just done it so many times. That's kind of the only advice I had. And it really helped me to start by doing it myself, that, you know, now I have somebody else who helps me with it, but I get to a point where I have a lot more ability to talk about what, how to change something or what I want, because at the very beginning, I just spent hours and hours and hours doing it myself.
So if your wife is telling you, oh my gosh, I can't believe you're doing it again, the correct reply is that Jordan told you to.
I am not going to, as a happily married person, I am not going to give anybody else any marriage advice.
That's probably a good plan. Well, yes. Last things last, if folks do want to find the Q Drinks products, we have an audience all over the world. Are you just located in the U.S.? Where can people find you?
We are mostly in the U.S. And in the U.S., we're at a bunch of fancy bars and restaurants, most high-end liquor stores. We're also at large retailers, including like Safeway and Target and Kroger and BevMo and Total Wine and Whole Foods. We're at a bunch of retailers, lots and lots of liquor stores as well. Most of our business right now is in the U.S. Each week we get, I don't know, 4 or 5 requests from around the world for people to say, hey, can you sell it to me in Madagascar? Can you sell it to me in Estonia? Can you sell it to me in London? And we are only doing a very little right now. I wouldn't be surprised whether next year we started doing some more, but primarily right now it's available in like Hong Kong, outside the US, Spain, Cayman Islands. We got, you know, half dozen places around the world that we sell it to. And my guess there's going to be more and more places, but they can look on our website, qdrinks.com. We have an availability page that's relatively up to date, or they can email us, info@qdrinks.com. And someone will probably email them back in within a day, telling them where they can get them nearby.
Perfect. That sounds great. Well, thank you so much for joining us and letting us hear your story. That is an amazing story.
Thank you. This was fun. I really appreciate it. And hopefully again soon.
Definitely. Cheers.
Okay. Cheers.
Hopefully you enjoyed that interview as much as I did and found it interesting and maybe even a bit inspirational. Thanks again to Jordan for coming on the show. By the way, you may have noticed Chris drop off partway through that interview. Sorry about that. The baby started crying, so he had to step away. I still think it went pretty well, and I hope you agree. Don't forget to catch the show notes at mixologytalk.com/92. Cheers! Never miss an episode by subscribing in iTunes or YouTube. And as always, check out the show notes by clicking on the right.